Well, good morning. It is an honor to be here at Wheaton College. I'm so thankful to God for you, for your school, for your faculty, for what the Lord is doing here. You know, if you were to go out onto social media, you could find a group of lists of X almost anything. You can find people who will come together who are ex-Mormons or ex-Scientologists or ex-Catholics or ex almost anything that you can think of. People who've had a bad experience, especially with a religious tradition, and people who are trying to find other people who have had bad experiences with those religious traditions to sort of share background and to build almost a kind of community in exile from those religious traditions. And as you know, we have ex-evangelicals all over the place. We have people who previously thought of themselves as evangelical Christians. Some of them have walked away from the faith. Some of them simply aren't sure what to do, whether or not they belong in this sort of gospel movement. Some people who still believe everything they believed, they just don't want to use that word evangelical anymore. I kind of get that phenomenon because I'm an ex-something too. I'm an ex-evangelical. And what I mean by that is I'm somebody who went through a crisis at the age of 15 where I started to look around and to say, could it be that with all of the scandals that I'm seeing taking place in Bible Belt Christianity, including people that I respected and looked up to who were proven later to be frauds in terms of what they said about their lives, or the way that Bible Belt Christianity would speak so definitively about sin and yet with very muted and ambiguous terms about sins such as racial injustice, or whatever happened to be happening with people who were especially powerful in that local congregation. What if, I wondered, Christianity is itself just a means to an end, and Christianity is just a way to turn people into good Americans? Thankfully, as a little kid, I had read The Chronicles of Narnia enough that when I passed a bookshelf in a bookstore and I saw the name C.S. Lewis, I recognized it and pulled Mere Christianity out. And I can tell you, I think that that book not only saved my faith, but probably saved my life. And it wasn't because of the arguments that C.S. Lewis was making in Mere Christianity. It was because I could get a sense, almost even in reading the book, in the tone of his voice, that this is someone who was not trying to sell me anything. This is someone who is not trying to enlist me into a political movement. This is someone who had encountered the living Christ and was pointing me back to the global body of Christ. And it was almost as though in reading that book, it was like a wartime radio-free Bible Belt of someone who was saying to me with that British accent, there really is more to Christianity than what you have seen. I think about that 15-year-old self of mine all the time because in many ways I'm still him. And in many ways, I look around and I see people who are going through that same sort of tumult all the time in their lives. And as you leave in the years to come from here and you're scattered out all over the country and all over the world, you're going to find people who are asking the exact same question. Is Christianity just a useful tool in order to get to something other than Jesus Christ? And the bigger problem is that there is going to be a persistent temptation for all of us to turn Christianity into a useful tool for something else. The passage that was read just a few moments ago is a passage where we have prophet Elijah who is going through this time of despair. He's going through this dark night of the soul. He's leaving a situation where he's fearful Jezebel has come forward and said, you've demonstrated that your God is God at Mount Carmel. I'm not going to stand for that. I'm going to stand up for Baal. And she essentially chases Elijah out into the desert where he starts to wonder, is there even any point in this? He says, I'm alone. I'm the only one here, and it would be better if I were to die. He's exhausted. He's discouraged. He's even a bit cynical here, and he's facing a situation where he says, all of the people around me have bowed the knee to an idol who is not God, and I am the one in exile. I am the one who is on the run. Now, it's easy for us to look at this and to say, well, Elijah is a really exceptional sort of person. I mean, he's a prophet of God. And yet the scripture tells us that the spirit of Elijah rests upon John the Baptist. And then Jesus tells us that the one who is the least in the kingdom of God is greater than John the Baptist. So your calling is not something that is less than that of Elijah the prophet. Your calling, no matter how scared you are, no matter how weak you seem, no matter how sort of uncertain you may feel to be, your prophetic calling is in many ways actually greater than that of Elijah, as you are pointing with John toward the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And so since that is the case, what you see happening here in the life of Elijah is not an exceptional sort of thing. What you see is the normal pattern of the Christian life, of what Jesus says is taking up the cross and following him. What you see here is not some sort of unusual crisis. What you see here in the life of Elijah is instead discipleship, what you and I have been called to do. And the problem that Elijah is facing is the exact same problem that you will be facing for the rest of your lives. You will find people when you explain, I'm an evangelical Christian, who will have all sorts of ideas of what that means. And you will find yourself having to unpack and explain what it means to be a people who are driven by the gospel. And over and against that, there will always be this figure of Baal. Baal is an idol, a figurine we don't ever see anymore. What Baal represents, though, is power. Baal is a fertility god. Baal is a rain god. Baal is a god of the crops. Baal is a god that grants power to people. And so when Elijah confronts the prophets of Baal, and Elijah is seen to be definitively proven to be right, God, if you are there, would you send down fire from heaven? And the fire falls. Wouldn't that be great. When you're sitting there having that conversation with your agnostic friend in the coffee shop, and you're talking through all the reasons that you believe in God and all the reasons that you believe that Jesus raised from the dead, if you could just say, God, if you're there, set this table on fire, boom, you know, then all you have to say is, are we finished here? Do we need to go further? And yet, what is happening here is Elijah, who even having seen all of that, is humiliated because here he is in the wilderness, here he is in this crisis where he is facing loneliness, he's facing weakness, and he's facing a fear about the future, sense of irrelevance. All of you will face that if you have not already. And what God is doing with Elijah here is essentially doing the exact same thing that he did at Mount Carmel. He's taking Elijah out into the wilderness to remove the Baal from Elijah. And notice how Elijah here comes out into the wilderness. He says, God, I'm all alone. There's nobody else who is standing up for the truth of the Word of God. I am the only one here, and I am failing. I do not see visible results here. I have no community. And yet, notice what God's doing. Baal can bring community. Baal was uniting the people of Israel around that sense of power. Elijah had to walk away from the herd and away from the mob out into the wilderness and to be alone, not for the sake of loneliness, but for what? So that there could be future community. And not only that, Elijah here, as he does this and as he's moving out into the wilderness, and as God is taking care of him every step of the way, when he says, I'm the only one here, God says, you are not seeing the full reality that there are yet 7,000 right now who have not yet bowed the knee to Baal. Elijah does not see the reality around him, and Elijah certainly does not see the reality in front of him. As the gospel is going to go forward out of Jerusalem and then into the uttermost parts of the world, right here to Wheaton, Illinois, Elijah faces this crisis of loneliness, but it's for the sake of community. That's the way of the cross. He also, though, here, you notice here, faces this crisis of weakness. Elijah is crying out to God, and the scripture says that God responds with a wind, but God was not in the wind. With a fire, but God was not in the fire. With an earthquake that is shaking the world around him, but God was not in that. Instead, there was just the thinnest sound of silence. Why? God is demonstrating he is not Baal. God is not a tool to be used. And God is not the embodiment and manifestation of power and of strength. Baal is power. Baal is winning. Baal is succeeding. And you can easily find a Baal that you can use to get you all of the things that you would want in your life, even if Jesus were still dead. And you can call that Baal the God of Jesus Christ. But that is not the God of Jesus Christ. The God of Jesus Christ is a God who shows himself in the weakness of one who is crucified, and a God who subverts all of the ways that we tend to see power right now. Some of you, maybe even right at this moment, are taking your entire sense of identity and you're binding it up in your academic achievement. Or you're taking your entire sense of identity and you're binding it up at your success in a relationship. Or you're taking your entire sense of identity and you're binding it up in the family dynamics that you have with your family. And some of you are at the point where you're under pressure and you're feeling this sense of weakness, and you think that your weakness is a sign that God is leaving you. When in reality, your weakness is a sign that God is with you. So that when the Apostle Paul says that the Holy Spirit prompts us to cry out, Abba, Father, and the Holy Spirit prompts us to groan as the Spirit testifies with our spirit that we are the children of God, that sometimes throws people because they think, I'm the one, I'm sort of always constantly in turmoil. I think about my own failings, I think about my own sin, I think about my own sort of tumult that I have inside, and there are always people who will say, well, that's a sign that I just must not be a Christian, because they think that what it means to be a Christian is to sit around in tranquility humming hymns to yourself. And yet what the scripture says is that sense of disturbance, that sense of weakness, that sense of being driven to the point of crying out and saying, I can't do this, is what the Holy Spirit does, because that's the kind of Christ Jesus is. And then notice finally, he's not just in weakness here, he's also having this sense of irrelevance. He doesn't see what God has said. God says, God doesn't explain to him, here's everything I'm doing in your life, Elijah. Here's everything that I have in store for you, Elijah. It's Elijah, go forward and you anoint those who are going to carry this mission forward into the future. The gospel does not center on any one of us. We are part of a global body of Christ that is moving forward, and no matter what is going on in an evangelical movement at the moment, no matter what is going on in any particular local church at the moment, no matter what seems to be going on in your life at the moment, the gospel is triumphant because Jesus has said at Caesarea Philippi, I will build my church, and Jesus keeps his promises. God here is looking toward the future. With the death of Billy Graham just a couple of weeks ago, people have been asking me consistently, where's the next Billy Graham? Who's the next Billy Graham? And my response to that has been to say, the next Billy Graham might well be passed out drunk in a frat house right now. The next Billy Graham might be running an abortion clinic right now. The next Billy Graham might be an Islamic jihadist right now. God does not work through some sort of genetic missionary force. God works by taking very unlikely people, turning those people around in such a way that not only are they no longer enemies of the gospel, but in many cases, they are the ones leading the advance of the gospel. A Saul of Tarsus, C.S. Lewis. The gospel goes forward toward the future because God is not panicked. God knew exactly when you would be born. God knew exactly when you would be born again, and God determined that you would be present in this age and in this time. And so whenever you look around and say, people don't understand me in the culture, I have a very difficult time in the outside world explaining what it means to follow Christ. I don't think that the gospel is really working. I can't, my parents think I'm crazy because I'm a Christian. My friends think I'm crazy because I'm a Christian, and I can't explain it to them. When we give up in despair, it is because we are saying to God, I deserve a better mission field than the one that you have given to me. If a sovereign God has placed you at this time and at this place and has given you a gospel that is big enough to fight for itself, then the response that we have is not to look around at the reality as it is. Our response is to say, the Holy Spirit of Christ works through loneliness toward community. The Holy Spirit of Christ works through weakness toward power. The Holy Spirit of Christ works through irrelevance toward the future. And we share that confidence as we go forward, recognizing and knowing that the future is not dependent upon me, because we're leaving. Whether you leave in a casket of pine or chariot of fire, you will be irrelevant, just as surely as Elijah was. The point of Elijah's ministry here is not anything that he's facing at the moment. It will be something that he will not see for over 1,000 years, and even then not see in fullness. When he stands transfigured in light toward Jesus of Nazareth, and the scripture says he is talking with him about what? About a visible demonstration of power? No. About vindication before the worshipers of Baal? No. About his legacy? No. About the cross. You will be taken in the way of Jesus Christ, and that means you will be taken through the way of the cross. That means that you will face loneliness. That means that you will face weakness. That means that you will face irrelevance. That does not mean that you are leaving the way. That is the way. And if you listen to the thin silence around you, then you'll hear the voice that you heard at the very beginning. Come follow me. That's how the evangelical movement revives. That's how the evangelical church stands back up, is with a confidence in the gospel and a crucifying of our own sense of power. That's how we have a rebirth for the reborn. Let's pray. Lord, I pray for the men and women in this room and for the ministries that you have given to them, the callings that you've given to them. Lord, even those in this room who don't know what your calling is on their lives, who have no idea what the future holds for them. Lord, would you bless them? Would you equip them? Would you send them forward with the cross of Jesus Christ? And we ask this in his name. Amen.